And we are back. Welcome back to the program. Mad Ball in the house. They just left to go over and do sound check for their show tonight. Key Club, go check it out if you're in the LA area.
Absolutely.
Now, there's so much to talk about. Great work on the piece.
Thank you.
But we are running a little long, so let's move the show along a little bit, shall we?
Step it up a notch.
Step it up a notch. So it is Halloween, and so we figured what better time to feature one of LA's hidden jewels, which is the Dearly Departed tours.
Absolutely.
And right here we have a clip from Dearly Departed, the film. Is that correct? And let's check it out. We'll be right back with Scott. Talk about it.
Right. So Decker was in the bathtub. He had been dead for several days. He had two hypodermic needles sticking out of his right buttock. So he was kneeling right there. He had a noose around his neck that was tied.
You lied!
He had it tied over this. He had two hypodermic needles in his arms, a noose around his neck, he had a scarf around his eyes, a woman's scarf, a horse's bit in his mouth with a rubber ball and a metal wire, and the bit had chain reins that were tied tightly behind his head, a leather strap around his neck and chest, and a third belt around his waist that was tied to a piece of rope that led down to his ankles that were tied to a timber hitch. Well, see, this is the thing. Now, and then they had, he had written on his body in red lipstick. Above the two hypodermic needles was the word whip. Written on his throat were the words make me suck. Written on his chest were the words slave and cocksucker. And just below his navel was a vagina, all drawn in red lipstick. Now, he also had handcuffs on, and the noose was held in his handcuffs. And the key was in the handcuffs. That was important, too. It was ruled accidental suicide. The guy was doing what we now know is autoerotic asphyxiation, which is strangling yourself while you masturbate, as you do, because it's supposed to increase your orgasm. But honestly, I have his autopsy report right here, and we went through it. Actually, they found marijuana in the apartment, some pill bottles and stuff like that. But after pouring through this autopsy report, word by word, the poor guy never even completed the job. All that work for nothing. No, he didn't come. But no, so yeah, they removed him. You know, it's from right here. This all happened right here.
That's so awesome.
I wish I had my camera.
And that was a clip from the film, the documentary Dearly Departed. And Todd's got it right there.
Right here.
And
Dearly Departed.
Next to me is Scott and Mike, the creators of the film and of the Dearly Departed tours here in LA. Welcome to the program. Thank you. Thank you for having us. So give my audience a little brief synopsis of what it is you guys do, because it's fucking fascinating.
It really is. I started my tour about 3 years ago, and it's a three-hour tour, covers about 37 miles, where we chronicle where all the famous deaths and scandals happen all around Los Angeles.
Right.
I call it a lighthearted look at the dark side of Hollywood. There's some pretty gruesome stories, but I try to keep it a bit more up-tempo, you know, because some people, you know, mom and pop from Wisconsin, don't want to get too rattled.
But are they going to even sign up to do something like this?
Oh, yeah. Well, I do okay. You know, it's just I've been in the business for 3 years, and this is my best year so far, so it's progressively getting better.
Is this time of year a particular spike in business?
Yeah, Halloween is definitely...
People want to get out there and see what's going on?
Well, they're fair weather fans, like, you know.
Yeah, of course. So let me ask you, what would I expect? I've not taken the tour. I'd love to. Todd and I would love to join the tour one of these days. What can we expect to see? What are some of the hot spots on the tour?
Well, it covers the more infamous locations where, say, the Black Dahlia was supposedly murdered, the Menendez murders, of course, and the Manson murders.
Right.
Up until about a year ago, we were doing the Ambassador Hotel where Bobby Kennedy was killed. But we also do...
Is that still standing?
No, they took it down.
They took it down. I did a photo shoot there once. It's really...
It's spectacular, wasn't it?
Great vibe, creepy vibe.
Yeah, very much so. And but we also do sort of the corner where the guy that played Fred Mertz on I Love Lucy dropped dead. And
isn't that the Roosevelt? No, the Knickerbocker.
Very, yeah, good.
I know that's good. Know your deaths.
Very good.
Yeah.
You know, but we also do film locations. We do the house where the woman lived that jumped off the Hollywood sign, the letter H, in 1932.
Oh, really? And you know, I can see the Hollywood sign from my home.
Yeah?
Yeah. The H somewhere.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, the only documented suicide that ever took place off of the Hollywood sign, actually.
Wow.
That was in 1932.
Was she a failed actress?
Of course.
That's so poetic and beautiful.
And then she became very famous in a way she never possibly could have planned.
Yeah.
And then, you know, there's some more less known things. Like right around the corner was a house where a man named Peter Duell, who was in a show in the 70s called Alias Smith and Jones, blew his brains out. But I tried to point out sort of the interesting facts, things that people didn't know about things that they thought they knew everything about. For instance, everyone knows the woman jumped off the Hollywood side, or a lot of people do.
Yeah.
But a lot of people don't know that her stepson was actually the guy that played Uncle Bill on Family Affair, who killed himself 13
oh,
years
really?
Ago.
Oh,
yeah.
Really? That show had a lot of darkness in
it. Yeah, it was a little Buffy, and
side note here, I'm just noticing, is that Zippy the Pinhead?
It is,
there?
Yeah.
Look at that. That's a fucking awesome tattoo.
Yeah, so it was actually Zippy's based off of Schlitzy from Freaks, and Schlitzy was
many times.
Schlitzy was, I was a big fan of Schlitzy, so you know, yeah, Freaks is a big thing of mine.
Do you guys go by Hollywood Forever Cemetery? Do you go to grave sites, or is it more like where tragedy?
No, it's like a tour of the stars' homes, but not where they lived. It's right. see the stars' last stops.
Now, are these stops, are they always a tragic end, or is there just someone where you don't go by somebody's house who just happened to pass in their sleep?
Well, sure, yeah, because it may make getting to from point A to point B a little bit more interesting. Mm-hmm. You know, we pass Agnes Moorehead's last.
Oh, home, yeah.
You know what I mean? It makes the tour a little bit more interesting instead of just not saying anything. So yeah, there's a lot of stuff. It's a jam-packed 3 hours and 15 minutes, and you see over 100 locations where things happen, so it's pretty intense.
That's easy. That's not easy to do in L.A. with traffic and trying to hit 100 locations. How about, do you go up Cielo? Do you go to the...
Well, you know, since the Tate House, the Manson murders in 69, since the Tate House was destroyed in 93,
yeah.
I took it off the tour. I do, however, once a month, a Helter Skelter tour, just Manson stuff.
Okay.
So we do that on Saturday mornings, and we take people to where they threw the gun out the window of the car, where they threw the clothes up, where they hosed off in the guy's driveway.
Wow.
You know, it's all that sort of stuff.
Now, is the La Bianca House still around?
Yeah, that is still there, still intact. Somebody asked me recently if L.A. was burned, what would I take with me? It would be that house, because you know, because I wanted to stay. You know, I don't want anyone to tear it down, because I think it's an important part of our history. Some people may not think so, but I think it's that story is L.A.
Oh yeah.
You know, and it would break my heart if somebody took it away. It's a horrible thing to have happened, but it still deserves to be remembered.
Absolutely. Are there now? Have you guys experienced any? I mean, this is an obvious question. Any paranormal experiences? Do you believe in that? Has there been any? Contact or connection with any of these spots, or have you felt something different? Because I'll tell you, when I drove by the Cielo lot, which is just an empty lot now, I used to live around the corner, I could feel it. I wouldn't know necessarily call it paranormal, but I could feel that there was an intense energy there.
Yeah, I think that's part of that's the freak out factor too, because you know what happened there, and you could sense what a horrific event that was. But on that being said, when they tore the house down in 93, I went up there to try to scavenge a brick from the place, and the guy told me that there's no bricks, but here's the fireplace. And he says, if you want, I'll leave you a brick outside the gates for the fireplace, and you can have it after I leave, because I don't want to get in trouble.
Right.
And I went back up there, and he didn't leave it for me, but he pointed out the brick pile, so I filled up my trunk with these bricks, you know?
Yeah.
And I keep these bricks in a box in my house. And I never believed in ghosts or any of that sort of stuff until about a year ago. And so I, you know, I'm probably sound like a nut talking about this stuff,
but
weird things.
Look what you're talking to.
It was just sort of waking up about 3 or 4 in the morning, and by this wall in my bedroom, I just see this sort of glow. And I had a psychic, because what I do, I meet lots of psychics, lots of ghost hunters, and I had them come into my house, and they went straight to my laundry room. And they said, something's in here, and in there was the box of rocks
from
the Tate House. And they said they weren't haunted so much as it was sort of residual energy, because of the event that happened in front of them, because there's such a huge concentration in that little space. But that being said, here's yours.
Wow, awesome. Look at this. Are you kidding? I can have this?
Oh yeah, that's for you.
And this is a piece of Sharon Tate's
The fireplace, the ferocious murder that happened right in place, in front of it.
Right in front of it.
Right in front.
And so now this energy is potential. Thank you, by the way, because I collect all this kind of stuff, and this is awesome. This
is awesome. Amazing.
But are you telling me that there might potentially be some energy that...
It's not negative energy. It's just something, I think, because of what happened in front of them, and because I had such a huge concentration of them in this box... I don't think one single rock's going to make that big of a difference.
I don't either.
But I think as long as you treat it with respect and you know, start dipping it in blood and stuff like that, I think it'll be fine.
No. This is it's amazing. Thank you so much.
It's an important part of history.
It really is. And now I have a piece of that history.
That's amazing.
Look at that, dude. So,
you know what I love is actually that we live in a culture where the brick got a round of applause.
The brick got a round of applause.
The brick got a round
and
of applause.
And incidentally, it is almost shaped like
a coffin,
like
isn't
a toe pincher right there.
Crazy.
That's awesome. So, Mike, you worked on the documentary we just saw.
Right.
Which is entitled Dearly Departed.
Correct.
What's the film about? What's the context in that?
Well, the first film we did is really just a mixture of stories, really just mimics his tour, where if you go along, there's a million different stories spanning back, 80 years in Hollywood history. And then, so I think we did over 100 50 or 60 locations for that one, feature-length documentary. It's very fast-paced. Each segment's maybe only 5 minutes long, so if one thing doesn't really interest you, you're right into the next story right after.
Is it a good supplement for somebody who can't necessarily get out here and take
Absolutely.
The tour?
Absolutely. Yeah, we've got a lot of people that live in like England or Australia who can't make it out here. They bought the DVD instead, and it makes them want to take the tour more, but it's obviously the next best thing.
Yeah, and also we touch on subjects that aren't touched on in the tour. We couldn't get down to Downey where Karen Carpenter died, but
right.
we did that
right.
with the DVD.
I was recorded in a studio where Karen Carpenter had worked.
Over on La Brea?
Yeah. Did you really?
Yeah, I used to work there. There's a great ghost story there with that theater. I don't know if you know.
No, I know.
Studio. Yeah, they
that's the Chaplin studio, right?
Yeah,
the old
exactly.
Chaplin
yeah.
studio.
They can't record there from I think it's 2 to 3 a.m. every morning. So they'll because that place is open 24 hours a day and they're doing all night recording sessions. And I heard a story where these guys were in there recording and at 2 o'clock hit and they're like, okay, take a 30-minute lunch break or whatever you guys want to do. And they said the producer came in and he was pissed off. He said, what do you mean we're shutting down? He said, we can't record from 2 to 3 a.m. We get sounds and weird vibes on the recordings. And this was in the actual. The actual studio that was the one that the Carpenters recorded in.
Wow.
And the guy said bullshit, and he said, yeah, everybody says that. So he played back one of the recordings. And if you crank up the volume on it, you can hear, it sounds like the room is full of people. Like there's like a million different, 20 years worth of history is crammed in, like overlapping. It sounds like a party's going on, basically.
That story isn't more well known.
Right.
Is because in this day and age, you're never going to find a musician who's going to be working at 2 or 3 in the morning. Nowadays, we just go in there and we just kind of do some stuff and let them chop it together later.
They also, whenever they record in that one studio there, they always play Carpenter's tune before they start a recording session
to kind
of placate the spirits and also just out of respect.
Yeah. Now, in the documentary, like obviously on the tour, you can point at the location and talk about what's happened. In the documentary, is there more visuals? Like, do you put up photos and old file footage and... incorporate that with...
Well, Scott has a huge collection in his house of stuff like The Rock, but he also he's a historian, so he has tons of files. He has all the autopsy reports, all the death certificates, everything. So in the movie, we take snippets from the actual documents so you can see... It makes it a little more interesting.
I have a website that I've been working on for 5 or 6, probably more than that by now, years, called Find a Death, and where I chronicle the ends of people's lives.
Wow.
And I've met a lot of people through doing this, but I've also became friends with the coroner, the chief coroner of the city of Los Angeles. So now we're on a first name basis, and I'll just zip over an email saying, do you think you could scare up this autopsy report for so-and-so? And then a couple of weeks later, I get it in the mail, and it's a great friend to have in my line of work.
Reminds me of an old joke. Do you know who the last man to make love to Marilyn Monroe was? Thomas Noguchi.
These guys get it.
He's my hero.
I think the freakiest thing we've done so far, we're shooting now the Manson DVD.
Yeah.
The follow-up. I think the scariest thing we've probably done on any of these shoots was going down to the apartment of the coroner in downtown L.A. and being in the crypt. For someone like me, I'd never been around a dead body before, so we actually walked into a room where there were probably over 100 dead bodies stacked.
Yeah, just see right
eyes
stacked 20
deep.
It's crazy.
Yeah, it was wild.
Is there a question on the IM? Because
yeah, there is actually. One of the questions.
A good one.
There's one. It'll do. No, but it is a good question. Which death are you most fascinated with? Do you have a favorite or a favorite story of?
Well, that would certainly be the Manson murders. I mean, that's there are certain things like the Black Dahlia and Marilyn Monroe that are interesting in that there's just an endless amount of information available.
But on those, there's no concrete evidence like there is on the Manson documentation.
That's true, because most of those people are still alive.
Yeah.
The people that did it are still here, and there's no conspiracy theory about that. Right. We all know who did it.
Yeah.
And so therefore, it's not a mystery. But the other ones are still sort of a mystery because of that, and therefore, there's still a fascination. I don't spend too much on as much time as conspiracies, but yeah, they're still interesting.
What is it with deaths and murders that is becoming such a cultural phenomenon right now?
Isn't that weird?
It really is the most darkest of subjects, yet I spend half my time watching, you know, another 48, you know, first 48, and, you know, any kind of murder, like forensic files, shit that I can take a look at, you know, information like this. Obviously, I'm well-versed in it, and, you know, I own Gacy's, and what is it that you've learned fuels that fascination?
I think that the internet has made the world a lot smaller. I mean, you go, if the biggest sexual thrill for you is to find someone that will clip your little toe, you'll find your soulmate on the internet.
Of course.
Therefore, the people that are grave hunters and the people that are obsessed with these things have all found each other now. And there's not that many taboos left. You know, it's really kind of uncommon, or very common, to click on something on the internet and see a pair of tits, you know, staring at you or anything. It's, who cares? You know, but 10 years ago, that would have been a bit more shocking. But
yeah,
there's just not much more left that's a taboo. And death is the biggie, because still no one's been there,
yeah,
really, and can come back and talk about it.
Do you have any, have you noticed reaction becoming much more acceptable over the years to this subject matter that you guys are obviously fascinated with and work in? You know, in the early, when you started getting into this whole world, was it a little bit weirder to onlookers than it is now?
There's always been, I've always got the judgment call. You know, you get the people looking down their throat, they go, oh, you know, you're sick, and then you show them their file of death certificates, and then, strangely, you know, they eventually
it's
go over to it, and they, you know, they start flicking, and an hour later, they're still there. So there's always been that, but I think, as I said, I think the internet and then 5,000 channels of television,
yeah,
have just made people a bit more focused, and the people that want this stuff will find it.
Oh, yeah.
We still get hate mails.
Oh, yeah.
Our YouTube video, one of the trailers we put up, Jack Cassidy was in our first CBD, and his son, one of his sons, came by our YouTube and actually left a message on our YouTube.
Wow.
I think it was the least famous of the Cassidy brothers. You know,
oh,
you guys
right,
got
right,
it
right,
wrong or whatever. I'm so offended.
But we got into the apartment where Jack burned in a fire.
Wow.
And, you know, so there we are, and we had the picture of the fire, and it faded to the place today.
And you're just documenting, you're not spinning.
Yeah. Right.
So, well, I want to thank you guys for being here. Dearly Departed, and check it out, dearlydeparted.com.
DearlyDepartedTours.com.
Tours.com, and where can we get the film if you want to?
That's on findadeath.com or DearlyDepartedTours.com. They're both on the top page.
Right on, man.
Thank you.
Thank you guys so much, and thank you for my brick. So, Todd,
yes,
what do we got next week?
Next week we have a little treat, a best of Fred Entertainment Show. Best of show. So you guys can check that out next week. Let's thank Madball for being down. They were awesome. Let's thank Dearly Departed Tours and Find a Death and Scott and Mike. And that's it, man. It was
a great
show tonight.
All right, and the next time we see you guys, because next week is the best of show, next time we see you live, we will be in our new studio, our new location, and please don't forget to go to tvguide.com and vote for Spread Entertainment as best web talk show. I'm Dave Navarro signing off. Thank you.